Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Sean Hudgenwood, and I'll be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name, and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This simply means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabets that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach according to the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Later on, he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Eunice Reiser. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be Isaiah, the 55th and the 56th chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Marlon Love.
Good morning, class. Good morning. Let us bow our hearts and mind in a moment of prayer. Gracious Father Yahweh, you have allowed us once again the gift and the opportunity to be in a school that you have ordained that we may come into a profound knowledge and understanding of the reality of your true existence. And we ask that you open up our hearts and mind to receive the truth, to accept the truth, and that by that we will live the truth. We thank you for the tumultuous things that you have taken us through, because we know they're only to show forth your love, your mercy, and your grace, and that you have given us the opportunity to be here in any kind of conditions, that the physical body may go through these things. But if our mind and our heart is on you, all things can be accomplished. So we ask that you continue to bless us in our class and presenting the true gospel throughout the world, throughout on Zoom, YouTube, and it is so many things that you have revealed. Only thing I can say is we thank you, and we ask that you continue to strengthen us. All these things and many others we ask in thy son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Good morning, class. My name is Marlon Love, and I'll be reading the scripture reading this out this morning. I will be taken from Isaiah, the 55th and 56th chapters. I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by A.B. Traynor with the Scripture Research Association, Isaiah 55 and 56. Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Incline your ear, and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and a commander to the people. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee, because of Yahweh thy Elohim, and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. Seek ye Yahweh while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto Yahweh, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our Elohim, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith Yahweh. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I said it. For ye shall go out with joy, and be led forth with peace, and mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. And it shall be to Yahweh for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Thus saith Yahweh, keep ye judgment and do justice, for my salvation is near to come, and my righteousness to be revealed. Blessed is the man that doeth this, and the son of man that layeth hold on it, that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, and keepeth his hand from doing any evil. Neither let the son of the stranger that hath joined himself to Yahweh speak, saying, Yahweh hath utterly separated me from his people. Neither let the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. For this saith Yahweh unto the eunuchs that keep my Sabbath, and choose the things that please me, and take hold of my covenant. Even unto them will I give in my house, and within my walls, a place and a name better than of sons and of daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. Also the sons of the stranger that join themselves to Yahweh, to serve him and to love the name of Yahweh, to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from violating it and taketh hold of my covenant. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon my altar, For my house shall be called an house of prayer for all people. Yahweh, which gathereth the outcasts of Israel, saith, Yet will I gather others to him, beside those that are gathered unto him. All ye beasts of the field, come to devour you, yea, all ye beasts in the forest. His watchmen are blind, they are all ignorant, they are all dumb dogs, they cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Yea, they are greedy dogs which can never have enough, and they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look after their own way, everyone for his own gain, from all quarters. Come ye, say they, I will fetch wine, and we will fill ourselves with strong drink, and tomorrow shall be as this day, and much more abundant. I have read Isaiah, the 55th and 56th chapters. Let us all say,
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Reiser, and thank you, Dr. Love. Before we get started, we'd like to welcome Dr. Love back from his trip. He's with us via Zoom today, just out of the abundance of caution. He's a little under the weather and wants to be sure that if it's anything, that he doesn't spread it to anybody. But he just wants to reassure everybody that he's okay. And he'll be back with us as soon. And he can say it himself sometime if he'd like to give a testimony. But would you like to give a testimony first, or would you like me to call a speaker, Dr. Love?
I'll say a few words.
Okay.
It's good to be back. It's good to be back. And we all returned safely. We had a fabulous time in Orlando at the symposium, Unity and Yah, for the 4 days, and quite a bit was said. I'm sure that those that went, Eunice and Annette, would concur with me on that note. We were able to gather 8 souls that attended the Unity and Yah that traveled with us also to the Bahamas in order to visit my brother in there, Sybil Lewis. So many of you might have seen some of the images on Facebook and a certain of the links that we provided for the images to see. And it was a great time to have spent with Sybil there and supped with her and ate with her and talked a little bit of gospel. And she showed us a marvelous time around the island there in the Bahamas on the east side of the island. A lot of things were manifested to see the strength and the understanding that she has, and to possibly the books that we brought from other members of the class. We were taken to her Holy Name Bible. We took her the textbook, the LAM, the Archetype Pattern of the Universe. We took to her the pamphlet books that were compiled in the booklet, and also a flip chart. And she hadn't had any of that information readily available. If she did, it was, old books that she's used for years. So she was very gracious and humble to have received those things. So it was a pleasure and honor to be able to deliver those from the other brethren around the country to her. With that being said, I'll elaborate more probably Tuesday or Thursday when I come in person and share more of the gospel that I took from the Unity and Yah. I don't want to take the time in this fashion to do it when we got people there that's come down to teach the gospel. So I'll save that part for later, but just letting you know that everybody returned safely and we continue to march on. With that, I have my place.
Thank you, Dr. Love. So for our first speaker, I would like to call on Dr. Samuel Salas. Dr. Salas?
Yep, thank you. Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It's an honor and privilege to stand before you and testify some of the things I learned in all this long time. Long time for me, but not for Yahweh. Yahweh has been with us all the time since the creation. He never leave us. And we in this school, we learning according to the founder, Henry Clifford Kinley. We follow the steps of Yahshua the Messiah all the way since Adam was made of the dust of the earth. Yahshua has been with us and never leave us alone. I am aware of that. He's everywhere. He's been with us all the time. I mentioned one more time. And as I mentioned before, I have some kind of stroke and I don't have the ability I had before. The walk, run from one corner to the other, shown in the charts, which are marvelous. But those are pictorial illustrations. The reality is what Yahweh showing us or explain us the meaning of the things. Those charts are beautiful, colorful. Looks like somebody mentioned like those old circus wagons painted. This is the way they look like, but there is a lot of meaning in these charts. This was the first one who was made. It's been called the elementary chart. And actually, those are made according to the purpose of plan. And oh, Yahweh, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Everything is 1, 2, 3. Nazi escape, 1, 2, 3. Atom or cell. Everything is made from atom of cell and cell. And those charts are made 1, 2, 3, but those are plates. And we learn from them. There's a lot of meaning and a lot of things have to say about these plates. This is the plate in the elementary chart. How Yahweh made man and put him in the garden. You can see him right here. And he was after the disobedience of him. We can say disobedience was purpose that way. It was conscience. It was not deceived. She was deceived. She was the weakest one because she was taken and made from the rib of a man. And she was tempted by Lucifer. And some people say, snake speak to Eve and told her to eat from the tree, which was prohibited for her to eat. But we never see a snake speak. But Lucifer is the serpent is the most, how we call it, the most subtle of the animals. You know how to deceive. the serpent, a person who is good for deceiving people, he can be called a snake. Like somebody lying or say something and you discover him, the way he goes, you say, oh, that person is evil. It's a snake. And now this is only a type in Charles. But this is the plates we learn all the time. When he fulfilled what Yahweh told him, he was not deceived, but he ate anyway to make the creation keep going. Without him coming out of this state, heavenly state, was not a reproduction of the man. All this one enabled the little one, and you see here the snake is coming down all over, little by little. You see here the snake, and you see here the snake again, and the snake is being with us all the time till this moment. You never leave us alone to see who he can catch. And I say this before. I remember when I see 100 of people in the school. In that time, I didn't know too much about the school. The only thing I knew for sure was the names you see right there in the chart, in the wall. I went to dictionaries and encyclopedias, and I see Yahweh Elohim in Yahshua. This one, Yahweh, I went to the encyclopedias and really researched the meaning of the tetragrammaton. This has been called tetragrammaton. YHWH, four consonants, cannot be pronounced that way, but you added the A of Adam and the E of Eve, you can pronounce Yahweh. And Yahweh wanted or not wanted, we pronounce his name every second of our existence, want it or not want it. If you or the person stop saying the name of the Creator, pretty soon he stop living. He cannot breathe no more, because you will say, Yahweh, Yahweh. We inhale oxygen and exhale oxygen. I am very impressive of this picture we have in here of Yahshua the Messiah and the cross. That's a beautiful picture. In reality, they try to paint the Savior according to the imagination, and it's very nice, but this is not the way he looks like in reality. It's not. It was beat so bad, it cannot be even recognized. It was hanged in the cross. This nail actually was right here. So this one was right here, because that's the only one a person can be hold. Here, he came down, because there is nothing to the nail can hold on into. Also, the feet is only one nail, not two nails. This is a little errors in this picture. You see this blood coming from this chest. A soldier put him to be sure he was dead. He put a lance in there, a spear, and water and blood came out of there. Both things, blood and water, not just water. And he didn't have a clothes on. They take the clothes out of him. He was beaten too bad, but they put him a crown on him, and then they put him in the cross. That was an humiliation for a person in those days, to hang him in the cross. And they hang him in the cross between two robbers, Dimas and Gestas. I don't know if I pronounce right in English. But I can say it's a beautiful picture, but this is not the way he looks like. You see here the son. He say, Father, thank you. I did my job. This is the meaning. I fulfill. And what he say this, the sun was coming down. So it's him. And you can see the snake over here follow him everywhere, and he still follow us till now. The elementary chart. And we have over here another chart, who is beautiful. We call Moses chart. Or we can have also another name, Exodus chart. Exodus mean coming out from somewhere. That's the meaning of Exodus. The reason why it's called Exodus, because the Hebrews came out of Egypt. They come out after Pharaoh say, go. I don't want to see you no more. Because then this vast plague, 10 plagues came pretty bad. First of all, the water turned into blood. Frogs, fire, famine. 9 happened. The first 3 was for the Hebrews and for the Gentiles, and the rest only for the Egyptians. When the last plague came, before that happened, an angel told the Hebrews, slay a lamb without spot and blemish. And with the blood, put in the door the dentils on top and the sides, and put a basin underneath. You can see 4 points of blood in here, in the door, and the inside. Whoever have this mark, the angel then came to the house and killed the firstborn. And that happened. That happened to the Hebrews. The firstborn was not killed. But in the Egyptians' houses, there was a big cry. Everybody cried there because they have a horse, they have a cow, or they have an animal or a person. The firstborn died. The firstborn of a soldier. You just name it. And after that, Pharaoh say, get out of here. I don't want to see you no more. But before they came out, they were told Abraham, who was the first Hebrew, they will be as servants for 400 years. By the end, they will come out of there with a great substance. Great substance means anything they ask for or they need it or valuable. And the Egyptian next day, they were crying, burying the animals and the children. And the Egyptian asked, hey, can I have this? Can I have that? Hey, take it, take it. I don't need it. I don't need it. They were in a big sorrow. So they went out of Egypt with a lot of substance. They could go for a land but they were Palestinians living there, and they don't want a confrontation in that time, so they took another place to go. Let me see if I can make a map here. See, this is Turkey. This is Canaan. And this is Egypt. And then River Nile. This is the Delta. Thank you, thank you. See, the Egyptian, they could go right there. Not the Egyptians, the Hebrews. When they were free from Egypt, they could go this way easy. But Palestinians living there in the coast, Gaza Strip, and other cities, and they prefer go to the Red Sea. But they stop in there. They don't want no confrontation in here. And the Egyptians change their mind and they follow to destroy them. But the Red Sea open as a tunnel and they cross. An angel was in front of them. An angel was in front of them. See, it was an angel. And not too long ago, I discovered who this angel was. When Moses, we have here the Exodus picture, he was a little boy, and Jezebel, her mother, cannot hide him for so long. He was 3 months old. He was a big boy, and the Pharaoh told to kill the baby boys and the baby girls, let her live. So Jezebel cannot hide Moses no more. She make a basket and put it in the Nile River and told her daughter to follow the basket. And she was follow the basket by the river to see who catch it or what happened to. And she see the daughter of Pharaoh taking a shower with the girls there. And she hear the cry of the baby and told one of the servants, go and get the basket for me. And when she opened the basket, she see the baby in there. He said, oh, it's a Hebrew baby. The reason why she say it's a Hebrew baby, because the baby was circumcised. And only the Hebrews used to be circumcised, and the Gentiles, no one was circumcised. Because the father of the Hebrews, who was Abraham, he was told to circumcise every man That way, they can be different from the Gentiles. I think before the 8th day, they have to be circumcised. And they keep that law for so long. And this is why the Pharaoh's daughter knew the boy was a Hebrew. Moses grew up as a big boy. He was 40 years old. 40 years old. As a prince, he grew up, good education, dressed nice, but he knows who he was. He knew he was a Hebrew. And one day, he was inspecting the constructions, and he seen Egyptian was mistreating a slave or a Hebrew. He didn't like that. So he hit the Egyptians. The Egyptian fell, but the Egyptian fell dead. And after he figured out, I killed him. He looked north, south, east, and west. And he said, oh, nobody watched me. So he make a hole, dig it, and bury it there. He's, oh, nothing happened here. He went whistle, went home, nice and happy. And nobody see me. But was one man see him? The man was being beat. He was there. So he went home and told his mother, mother, you know, a man saved me, but the one saved me killed a man. And I am the only one known because nobody was around. Oh, mother, don't tell no one. Okay, okay, my son, I don't tell no one. But she have a neighbor and say, you know what? My son was getting beat, and Moses saved him, and he killed a man. Next day, everybody knows what happened. One day before, two Hebrews, they were fighting next day, and he said, don't fight, don't fight. He tried to intercede to not allow them to fight. And he said, who made you a judge or ruler? You can tell us what to do. Or you want to kill us as you did the Egyptian before? So that way he knew. Everybody knows. He said, oh, I better get out of here. Otherwise, I might be persecuted or do something. So he ran to a land of a man, Jethro. He had 7 daughters, and the oldest one was called Zipporah. And Moses married her and had 2 sons with her. Was from the tribe of Cush. And Moses, it was 40 years. So when he came out of Egypt, he was 40 when he killed the man. He was taking care of the goats of his father-in-law. He was 80. And none of the goats was his. He owned nothing. And Moses was 80 years old then. And he was doing his job. And one day, he see a burning. Something burning. And not consumed. And he was very curious. And he see an angel in there. And it was a stone he want to see more, and I was told, don't come closer, stay there, take the shoes out of you, because the land you stepping on is a holy land. It was a holy land because this Egypt, the wilderness is a holy land, and Jerusalem is the promised land. This represents something spiritual, represent heaven, where the first temple was constructed by Solomon. But when he went out of Egypt, when he was 40, 10 years later, after he left Egypt, a man appeared as a 30 years old man. His name was Yahshua. And he never get old for 30 years till he come back 80. When he came back to Egypt to tell Pharaoh to leave the people out of Egypt, he was 30 still. Never get old. From that time, the time start counting for him. He start getting old too. Because Yahshua, he was called Oshia, the son of Nun. But he died as a 110 years old. And it was Moses' minister. In other words, he was telling Moses what to do. Minister. This is what the minister do. Tell him in the ear, do this. Give good instructions, because he had to be very knowledgeable. And these charts, I can go on and on all day, and I never finish to explain you what it's all about. When Moses see the burning bush, he was given an order. Go to Egypt and tell Pharaoh to lead my children out of Egypt. But they were slaves for 400 years. They were doing the heavy job. And the Egyptians, they were not doing anything. They're only bosses. And Pharaoh said, no, I cannot do that. We cannot. We have to have servants, otherwise we can be ruined. We need someone to do the job. And he denied all the time Pharaoh. He said, no. After he see the 10 plagues, finally his heart was softened because he lost his son. His son died. It's when he say, oh, get out of here. I don't want you no more. That's the time when the Egyptians cross the Red Sea and went into Sinai Desert. And it was a mountain there. This mountain. And Moses went 3 times into this mountain. The first time he went there, he given a verbal law. He was instructed the people had to be clean 3 days, the clothes nice, clean, and don't have to come too close to the mountain. Not even touch, not even an animal can touch this mountain. Who an animal can close, he can die. And if the people can go there, they can kill him or they can die. So Moses went himself in there, and he received the Ten Commandments, and he came down and gave it to the people. And the people say, all what Moses say, or Yahweh say, we will do. Don't worry. But we don't want Yahweh talk to us no more, because the rocks break and too many things happen. We don't want things happen. So you, Moses, tell us what to do and we do it. And then Moses saying, I will go one more time to the mountain as Yahweh instructed me. And but I had to go alone and by myself. This is the order Yahweh gave me. Alone and by myself. Next day, Moses and his minister Joshua arose and went and topped the mountain. Also, 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, they were his sons, but they stayed in the plateau. But Moses, he went upstairs to the mountain with his minister Joshua. And what happened in here, he went so high, it was a cloud covered the mountain. The cloud represent eternity. Moses went into eternity time, when the time don't count. And he see, he have a panoramic vision. He see many things in there. Good memory. He keep everything in his mind. He see Elohim of Israel. This is the mystery, who Elohim is. No man can understand Yahweh. Yahweh is pure spirit. Pure spirit, incomprehensible and indiscernible. But to be comprehensible and discernible, it had to have a shape and form to be perceived, because in the invisibility, nobody believes. They can hear something, they forget next day. And Moses see the Elohim without flesh and blood. It's only been seen in a visions and a revelations. And Moses then see he Elohim transformed into unchangeable sanctuary or three parts. Most holy place and corona about. 1, 2, 3. And from there, the creation became to exist. Remember, this is a Moses vision. This didn't happen that way. It's a vision he had. Moses showing him how he created everything. And other person have also a panoramic vision. It was John in the island of Patmos and the Aegean Sea. He had the same vision and revelation. You see, the high priest who was or is Yahshua the Messiah, and he see the tabernacle also, and he see the Elohim. The way Moses see this way. And John and the Isle of Patmos see in this way. the panoramic vision of Elohim to John A.D. after the death of Yahshua the Messiah in the year 96. This is not actually this way, because Yahshua never died. But we put it here to people understand when that happened. And Agent C is in Greece. We have a map. I hope I can walk all the way. It's down there. We have a map of Europe, Africa, and Asia. See? The island of Patmos is somewhere in here. This is Turkey, Greece, Macedonia, Italy, Germany, Egypt, and this chart, I already showed you this one. The serpent, Lucifer, Eve, Adam. The angel told them, Adam, you eat, I tell you not to. Go out of here. You have a flaming sword. That way, it cannot come back. And it was spelled, and you see the serpent in there. This is symbolic. And you see here, Adam was working. He was eating with his wet of his, with the blood. Eve, Cain, and Abel. This is the Nilo River. You see the delta. Ochan, the best land where the Hebrews used to live. The Hebrews cannot take a bit of the mosquito or something. They live somewhere in the desert. But the Egyptians, the Hebrews used to live around here. Delta. These are rivers. I just discovered this. The Nilo River is not the longest of the world. In South America, the Amazonas River is the longest one. But this is, in those days, rivers never born in the south and go north. The river used to come from north to south. This is a phenomenal thing. Well, I want to tell you, this picture have a name in here, INRI. See, there is a letter they call Greek I. Nobody heard about this before. I never heard it here in this school. In Spanish, Greek I. Greek I. Sí. We have a name here. Yahshua. Nazarene. King of the Hebrew. This is the meaning of Henry. Means the end. When they crucify him, he fulfilled everything. He came to be crucified. Right. The purpose of him is die for the human being. This is why he died in the cross, because he was fulfilling from the beginning of the creation. This is the first crucifixion. Right. From pure spirit, visible. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean it's not pure. It's pure, but visible. Well, I can go a little bit more, but I better take my seat and give opportunity to someone else say something. Thank you so much. I hope you have something out of this class. Have a nice, beautiful day. And thank you so much one more time. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Salas. The baby will be the next speaker. I'm joking. I appreciate the remarks from Dr. Salas, and I'll be your third speaker. I know the last time I said the first speaker would be Dr. Salas, but the first was actually Dr. Love. And I'll be your third speaker today, and I appreciate the opportunity to be able to stand before the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak anything that I've come to know and understand since coming down to one of these schools. And I must say that the previous speaker laid such a foundation that anybody could almost get up here and go any direction that they wanted to go with it. And I appreciate all of the things that that he went into. Briefly, when right before he stepped down, he mentioned that Greek I, and I looked it up, and I got to do a little bit more of an investigation on it, because I seen that character in the Greek alphabet, but it related to upsilon, U-P-S-I-L, O-N, and I don't speak Greek, so I seen what looks as we have the formation of the letter I is iota, but like I said, I'll have to do more of an investigation, but that's something to look into, and as is said, this is a school, so whatever is offered up, it's our due diligence to investigate these things so that we can come to a profound understanding of that is what we know. We don't want to assume anything. But it was very, very good and heartfelt testimony and discourse that the previous speaker went into. And I, like I said, I appreciate it. And he spoke about Moses having a panoramic vision. And he also spoke about John on the Isle of Patmos having a panoramic vision as well. And Moses having his vision of from the beginning to the end of the world. And John having his vision from the ending to the beginning. But they both had the same vision. They both seen the same thing. Revelation is nothing different than Genesis. It's just from a different perspective. And the founder of this school, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, also had a panoramic vision. And in his panoramic vision, you can see just by looking at the chart that he's seen Moses and John. And how he explained it, he's seen it open, he's seen the creation open up like a Japanese fan, seeing all the way around 360 degrees. So it would be like having eyes in the back of your head. It was no different than what Moses seen and what John seen. It was just a different perspective. The manifestation changed, but the principle of what he seen remained the same. Now, if we can get the scripture lesson today, is your mic on? Because it wasn't on most of the class. It's all good. But the scripture lesson today, I'd like to get into that a little bit, and maybe I can tie that in with some of the things that Dr. Silas was talking about as well. But let's go ahead and start with 1:55, okay. Please.
Oh, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. And he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good. And let your soul delight itself in fatness.
Now, we're not talking about Wonder Bread or Home Pride or Dasani Water or American currency or the euro here. That's not what Yahweh is talking about when he says he that hath no money, come ye buy and eat, buy wine and milk without no money and without price. It's not a physical thing that you're partaking of. These things fall away. But that which Yahweh is saying, he says, hearken diligently unto him.
Right.
Hearken diligently unto Yahweh. Listen, hearken. Can we get the definition of hearken, please? Hearken diligent unto Yahweh and eat that which is good, that which is righteous. Let your soul delight in fatness. You got it?
Listen, to give respect for attention, to bring to mind something in the past, hearken back.
That's good. That's good. So hearkening is listening. You listen, hearken diligently unto Yahweh and eat which is good and let your soul delight itself in his fatness. Your body is not what we're here to satisfy, our the flesh. It's our souls that we're here to satisfy. And we listen unto Yahweh. So that we can eat without price, because we're saved by grace,
right.
By his mercy is our salvation come upon us. So you can't pay for that. You don't deserve it.
Right.
Continue to read, please.
3. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David.
Listen, and your soul will hear, and I will make an everlasting covenant unto you. Now, this covenant that was made, that the previous speaker was talking about a little bit, this covenant was not an everlasting covenant.
Right.
This covenant had to come to an end because none of the people could complete and fulfill this covenant. So as in Jeremiah 31:31, if we get that and hold your finger there, it necessitated Yahweh to make a new covenant. And give me that real quick, and then.
Okay, Jeremiah 31:31.
Mm-hmm.
Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah.
Read.
Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand.
Not according to this covenant in the day that he took them out of the hand.
To bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, said Yahweh.
Every time you turn around and look at one of these Jews, they was breaking one of these laws, statutes, judgments, and ordinances that was given, even though they agreed to say that and said that all this that Yahweh said and thundered from the mount that they would do.
Right.
Go ahead and read.
But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel,
mm-hmm,
after those days, saith Yahweh.
Read.
I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their Elohim, mm-hmm, and they shall be my people.
So this law that they was given out here in the wilderness in Israel, I mean in the wilderness of Sinai, was it in their inward parts? Mm-mm. It wasn't in their hearts and in their minds. Not by no means at all. They had to fabricate these things called Teflon, like,
yeah,
Dr. Marlon Love, and put the law on their foreheads,
right,
and wrap it around their arms and embroider it onto their clothes and all of these different things. They had to write it down on tablets, and this was on tables of stone that was put into the Ark of the Covenant. That wasn't in their hearts.
Right.
That wasn't in their minds. They needed all kind of reminders to remember what it was to do.
Yeah.
That 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances. Now, a new covenant Yahweh said he will make that will be written in your hearts and in your minds.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Jeremiah still?
Yes, please.
And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know ye Yahweh,
mm-hmm,
for they shall all know me.
So you ain't going to have to go around and be like, don't do that, because that's against the law of Yahweh. You know how you raise your children up and tell them to look both ways before they cross the street and things? You teaching every man his neighbor. Don't do that. You know how they say when you're raising a kid, it takes a village. It's hard to do it by yourself. And, you know, you welcome when you're a parent, you welcome somebody to come in and share something good and fruitful with your kid, because that's all the best. You want to give them the best. You know, you want to keep them away from the garbage and the bad things and the sugar and the snacks and, you know, the Beavis and Butthead cartoons type of situation. You know, the negativity of the world.
Right.
But, you know, because that's corrupting them. But you want to teach them. And this under this new covenant, you no longer have to teach each other, because it's written in your heart. It's coming from within, this new covenant. And that's what I'm trying to express, that is being expressed in the scriptures here.
Mm-hmm.
Read, please.
For they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith Yahweh. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Thus saith Yahweh, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinance of the moon and of the stars for a light by night.
Now, Yahweh created this creation according to a pattern. And you've got the sun and the moon and the earth and the stars and all of the elements of matter that are all made according to this pattern. And that's what's being expressed right here. Mm-hmm. That those things, the sun and the moon and everything else, are a witness to what Yahweh's promise is. And we're reading here in Isaiah 55. Let's go back over to Isaiah 55 and pick it back up at 1 again.
Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money, without price.
Read.
Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not?
Wait, okay. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? When we come into this school, see, this is a parable here. Yahshua spoke in parables. If you don't understand the purpose of Yahweh, then you don't understand what he's saying right here. We lust after the flesh before we know anything about Yahweh. We look at the sun, and there are those who worship the sun in the sky. But that sun in the sky is not unto your eternal salvation.
Right.
That moon in the sky is not unto your eternal salvation. That woman or that man that you lust after is not unto your eternal. Is not going to satisfy your soul. It will only satisfy your flesh, and that flesh is never satisfied.
Yeah.
You get what you want, and then once you got it, you'll be satisfied momentarily, and then that'll grow old and you'll want more. But if you hearken diligently unto Yahweh, your soul will delight in fatness. You're not going to be hungry because you're going to have all the fat. And the sun and the moon and the universe are a witness unto that. Romans 1, 19 and 20, and then give me Hebrews 12th chapter. But Romans 1, 19 and 20 first.
Romans 1:19,
mm-hmm.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them,
mm-hmm.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Right. Read.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
The invisible things from the creation of the world. That's what we're talking about, where you witnessing it and using the sun and the moon as a witness. The invisible things from the creation of the world are clearly seen by the things, read,
being understood by the things that are made.
That's right.
Even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
So that they are without excuse, because everything is made according to the pattern that Yahweh took on shape and form as the Word. And when Yahweh took on shape and form as the Word, mm-hmm. Yahweh in pure spirit went out of business and gave everything of the creation to Yahweh Elohim, and everything that Yahweh Elohim created was according to that pattern. Mm-hmm. And that's a witness back to our Heavenly Father when you see that threefold nature. The 92 elements that we have are all threefold. There's one that seems to be twofold. Mm-hmm. And that's the hydrogen atom. Mm-hmm. And that hydrogen atom, you can see the proton and the electron, but that neutron is indiscernible. But it holds that proton and that neutron together. Something has to hold it together. It's there, you just can't see it. Therefore, that it is threefold as well. Mm-hmm. Yahweh gave a witness, and he's saying, learn of him, use what he's given. Hearken diligently to him. Use what he's given so that your soul can delight itself in fatness. Hebrews 12 and 1.
Beginning. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us.
Let us lay aside. We've got a great cloud of witnesses here. There's once you have Isaiah 28:9-10. Once you have been revealed something about this pattern, this tabernacle, and what this law represented as a kingdom to these Jews and to the Jews only, then you can use this as a schoolmaster to show or to see all of the different witnesses of the greater and more perfect tabernacle, which is the universe. And
Isaiah.
Go ahead.
You want Isaiah 28?
Yeah, please.
Isaiah 28:9-10. Whom shall he teach knowledge, and whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept,
precept upon precept, precept upon precept. Read.
Line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little.
Mm-hmm.
For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to his people.
For with stammering lips and another tongue will Yahweh speak to his people. You got down here on this migratory chart, you've got Yahshua in a meeting, in a tent with Moses and Aaron. And Moses in the wilderness, after fleeing out of the land, out of Egypt, after slaying the Egyptian and tarrying 40 years in the wilderness of Sinai and tending to his father-in-law's flock of sheep, he came to this burning bush, and Yahweh Elohim appeared to him out of the midst of this burning bush and commissioned Moses to go down into this, back into the land of Egypt, and bring the children of Israel out. And that Yahweh said he would do so by a mighty hand. Pharaoh would not let the people go. Now Moses was shown miracles, and he was given a rod. I mean, he had a rod. He was told to throw his rod on the ground, and his rod turned into a serpent. Mm-hmm. And he was told to pick up the rod by the tail, and when he did so, which any normal serpent, we know, you pick it up by the tail, it'll snap back on you and bite you. And it's real bad if it's a poisonous thing. But he picked it up, and it turned back into a rod. Mm-hmm. Now, a rod is the same, is similar to a scepter, and a rod symbolizes authority. Now, Moses took that rod down to Pharaoh, and he threw it down on the ground, and it turned into a serpent. And Pharaoh brought Jannes and Jambres, and they did the same thing. Moses' rod of authority swallowed up Jannies and Jambres, overpowering. Oh, that's unfortunate. Okay, we'll just give, can we?
Should I shut my phone off?
Might be a good idea, but if we got audio, that's good. How about we stop the OBS for a minute and then restart it, and we'll pause right there. We'll just pause for a second. Let me know when it's back up. See if we're picking up on, yes, we're picking up. Okay, we had some technical difficulties there. Our computer's glitching a little bit from time to time. If you could go to the OBS screen, you get a lot of those. Go to the OBS screen and share a full screen projector to the, all right, once again, we apologize for the technical difficulties that we're having. It happens sometimes. It's funny. Last class, I just made mention that there may come a time that technology fails us and we won't be able to broadcast our classes, you know. But yet and still, we endeavor to preach the gospel. So what we were talking about, I was talking about this rod of authority that Moses had. And get my train of thought back here. Jannies and Jambres, yes. Jannies and Jambres, magicians, Pharaoh's servants, if you will, they produced a rod that turned into a serpent as well. But Moses' rod had authority over their rod. And swallowed up the rod of Jannies and Jambres. And that just shows a witness. And what we're talking about here is a great cloud of witnesses that Yahweh is the ultimate. Yahweh is running everything here. And the creature, Jannies and Jambres, or Pharaoh, the son of perdition, the mystery of iniquity, is allowed to perform for a certain amount of time. But what Pharaoh and his host, or Satan and his host, are doing is perverting the true nature of spirit law, if you will. He's created according to the pattern, but he perverts that pattern, and he has no power. And that's what we're talking about here. That's what he's talking about here. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, in Isaiah? Now, give me over into Hebrews, I think it's 10 and 1. Now, we've got, as Dr. Love was just reading, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little and there a little. We have an innumerable cloud of witnesses to show forth back to Yahweh, taking on shape and form, and drawing out this entire creation according to a pattern. And in Exodus 25 and 8, Yahweh says, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. And that sanctuary is in the most holy place of that tabernacle. And for the next five chapters in Exodus, it explains in detail the structure and function of that tabernacle. And in the most holy place is where your cognitive abilities come from. That's where you take the mind out, you start messing around with the mind and the arms and the legs and all of the rest of the body, the liver, the heart, it's not going to start working right. You get to start poking and pushing in the wrong places in there, it'll take you out. Yeah. And this is where Yahweh may dwell. If you hearken diligently unto him. I mean, yes, obviously, Yahweh is the breath of life that breathes into all of you. But having a revelation and understanding of this thing allows him to dwell in righteousness, as opposed to what we have over here is that son of perdition that dwells in unrighteousness, that is the anointed cherub that covereth, that hides the true nature of Yahweh and has one to believe in the gods of this world, the sun gods, the moon gods, your girlfriend gods. Are we froze again?
Yeah.
We got audio.
Okay. Yeah, just go. You only got a few minutes left.
Oh yeah, we do. Okay. Hebrews
10:1.
Yes, please.
For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never, with those sacrifices which they offer year by year continuously, make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have had no more consciousness of sin. But in those sacrifices there is a remembrance again made of sin every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bull and of goats could take away sin. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he says, sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire.
Read.
My ears hast thou pierced, burnt offerings and sin offerings hast thou not required. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book, it is written of me. I delight to do thy will, O Yahweh.
Now, this explains that first law that was given to those Jews and those Jews only, it didn't satisfy the people. And he had, as we read over in Jeremiah 31:31, there had to be a new covenant that was ushered in, that was written in the hearts and our minds. And this covenant was not written in our hearts and our minds. It was written on tables of stone. Right. And now that had to be taken out of the way, so that new covenant could be brought into play. Now Yahshua the Messiah, that's exactly what he did. He walked the earth plain 33 and a half years, fulfilling the law, the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that was given to Moses and Israel. And when, upon his fulfillment, upon his death that Dr. Salas described in Golgotha, his crucifixion, he accomplished that law. And he was buried, performed the Sabbath, and he resurrected. And he outpoured his Holy Spirit on Pentecost, first to the Jews, and then 7 years later to the Gentiles. And that is the new covenant being realized. But he says, lo, I come in the volume of the book. In order for you to recognize what Yahshua the Messiah did, You search the scriptures. Now, what he said in John 5:39 is that ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, but they are they which testify of him.
Right.
Now, they're not giving you eternal life. They're giving witness to Yahshua the Messiah, which is our eternal life, because Yahshua is Yahweh being made manifest. First in the spirit, then in a body. Now, get me back into the scripture lesson and skip down to 12 in the 55.
55.
Mm-hmm.
55 and
12. 12. Mm-hmm. No, go 11.
11.
No, 10. Thank you. I'm sorry. 10.
You want to go with 8? No. For all the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater.
Now that's showing the cycle of life right there in a nutshell. In one little small paragraph, it shows the life cycle of the creation. But read.
So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void.
See, it shall not return unto me void, because that rain comes down and then the seed comes up and it sprouts up. And that pattern of the tabernacle, as Jacob's ladder is expressed, is ascending and descending. So my word, which we understand in this class, in this school, the word of Yahweh is Yahweh Elohim. Yahweh taking on shape and form as Yahweh Elohim, which is the word or son. And there's only one son under righteousness. That's the only begotten son is Yahshua. And in super incorporeal form, that is Yahweh Elohim. When you see him in a body, that's Yahshua the Messiah. When you can see him, you got something concrete, that's Yahshua the Messiah. And the only way to get back to the Father is through the Son. And that word will not return unto him void. Read.
But it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things whereunto I send it.
That is his purpose, pattern, and plan explained in a nutshell. Read.
For ye shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. And it shall be to Yahweh for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off.
That name will be Yahshua, nothing else. Now, because there's no other name. That's one of the aims of the school is to get you to know and understand that there's no other name given unto man whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua. Mm-hmm. Now, get me over in 1 Corinthians. We're almost out of time here. We always got to have some kind of technical difficulties. Always something. 1 Corinthians and 6th chapter. And let's just start at 1. We'll try to read this thing through real quick, and we'll wrap it up.
1 Corinthians 6 and 1. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to the law before the unjust and not before the Son? Do ye not know that the Son shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters?
Now this is after Yahshua the Messiah, walked the earth plane, died, buried, resurrected, and poured out his Holy Spirit. And that law of carnal ordinances that those Jews had out in the wilderness and ongoing up until Yahshua the Messiah has been fulfilled. And the new law that was promised in Jeremiah 31:31 has been actualized. And here we got, here in the book of Corinthians, we've got Paul saying, why are you going to the law against your brothers? Mm-hmm. But read.
Know ye not that we shall judge angels? How much more are the things that pertain to this life? If then ye have judgment of the things pertaining to this life, do ye set them to judge who are least esteemed in the assembly? I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? No, not one that shall be able to judge between his brethren. But brother goeth to law with brother, and that before the unbelievers. Now therefore there is utterly a fault among you, because ye go to the law one with another. Why do ye not rather take wrong? Why do ye not rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded? Nay, ye do wrong and defraud, and that your brethren. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of Yahweh?
Now stop for a second and hold that and go over to Romans, the 8th chapter, and start at 1, and then we're going to come right back to this. But I just want to point out what's read right here. Go ahead.
Romans 8 and 1?
Yes.
There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah.
There is no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah. Now, these Jews are going to the law against their brother, condemning each other, convicting each other, putting each other to shame, and there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah, showing their Yahshua Messiah has not been made manifest to them. They don't believe the report. And Paul is laboring to try to get these Jews to see that Yahshua walked the earth plane and died for their sins so that they don't have to do this thing anymore. But go ahead and read back in Corinthians.
Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of Yahweh?
Read.
Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor self-abusers,
read,
nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of Yahweh.
Now, we look at those things on a carnal level, and we think, oh, fornicating is going out being with a woman, and you're not really married to the woman, and all of these things. But you got to look at this on a spiritual matter, where Yahweh made a covenant with those Jews that and he gave them a law, and they said, all this that thou said we shall do, and he was a husbandman unto them, and they were a bride. Now you, if going on, this law has been taken out of the way, and a new law has been ushered in, where it's written in your heart and your mind, then you still got a husbandman, which is Yahweh, but you don't go to this law anymore. So now if you go into this law, you lusting after the flesh, this is the wrong husbandman. This is no longer to be, this is not the husbandman anymore. This is taken out of the way, and you got a new husbandman. You go to Yahshua, that you fornicating if you don't believe in Yahweh. If you don't hearken diligently unto him, that was what we was talking about, was being talked about in Isaiah 55. Continue to read here.
And such were some of you, but now ye are washed, but now ye are sanctified. But now you are justified in the name of the Savior, Yahshua.
Such were some of you, But now you are washed. Now you are sanctified. Now you are justified in the name. That name that Yahweh said he was going to give, that was going to be everlasting. Right. That name of Yahshua the Messiah. Right. You saved in him. Read.
And by the spirit of our Elohim.
By the spirit of our Elohim, which is the word. That is the word. That is the express manifestation of Yahweh taking on shape and form in detail, not by no willy-nilly circumstances or some kind of like a random course of events. Mm-hmm. That word, that spirit of Elohim is the shape and form of Yahweh, the express manifestation of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength wrapped up in kingdom. That is a new kingdom. We had a kingdom out here in the wilderness of Sinai, which was given to the Jews and the Jews only. And by this kingdom right here that was given to the Jews and through the seed of Abraham, all the families of the earth would be blessed. Now that Yahshua the Messiah has come in and took that kingdom that was given to the Jews and the Jews only out of the way, we can be saved in the name of Yahshua the Messiah, and the families of the earth are blessed by looking back at the volume of the book that Yahweh had drawn out, the manifestation of what the Jews had to suffer through up until Pentecost. Continue to read.
All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not profitable. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under power of any. Food for the belly and the belly for food, but Yahweh shall destroy both. Now the body is not for fornication, but for Yahweh, and Yahweh for the body. And Yahweh hath both raised up Yahshua and will also raise up us by his own power.
Read.
Know ye not that your bodies are the members of the Messiah?
Know ye not that your bodies are the members of the Messiah? Do you not know that? If you don't know that, you better get with the program here. Yep. Read.
Shall I then take the members of the Messiah and make them the members of a harlot?
Nope.
By no means.
Read.
What? Know ye not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body?
Unto corruption, unto death. Read.
For two, saith he, shall be one flesh. But he that is joined unto Yahweh is one spirit.
But two shall be one flesh. The woman got to go back to the man to procreate, to be fruitful and multiply. Because that's the commandment that was given to Adam, and we talking about the flesh right here. But now let's talk about Yahweh Elohim in spirit. Read.
Flee fornication. Every
well
sin
go 17th verse.
Okay. But he that is joined unto Yahweh is one spirit.
He that is joined unto Yahweh is one spirit. Now we got Paul over in the 7th chapter of Corinthians. The next chapter we ain't gonna read about it, but he's talking about being a husband and a bride unto Yahweh and not having a woman after the flesh. I think that's 1st or 2nd Corinthians, but hey, we don't got to get it. I don't know what it is, but you know what? Let's just continue to go. I just wanted to point out that two shall be one flesh with the man and the woman on the earth plane, but what we're looking to do is take our husband, Yahweh, our Elohim, and we don't need a woman for that life. And you have to die out of the flesh here in order to take Yahweh as your husband, man. Go ahead and read 18th verse. Flee that fornication. Read.
Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body.
Mm-hmm.
But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body.
Read.
What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit which is in you?
What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit which is in you? You need to know that. Read.
Which ye have of Yahweh, and ye are not your own.
Read.
For ye are bought with a price.
Right.
Therefore, glorify Yahweh in your body and in your spirit, which are his.
Now, I know I'm out of time. I wanted to get that read because in Isaiah 55, it said, come and get buy and eat without money and without a price. But you are bought with a price. You just can't pay that price. Yahweh pays that price for you. Now, give me John 17:3, and we're done. What is that? This is life eternal. We're done after that. And that's it. I know we're out of time.
John 17:3.
Read.
And this is life eternal, that they might know that thou only art the true El, and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
Now, this is life eternal, that ye might know that thou art only the true El, and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent. And Paul is saying right over in Corinthians, what, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, and which ye have of Yahweh,
right,
and ye are not your own. These scriptures are trying to teach you something. Here, and we want you, this school is trying to teach you something, and we want you to learn it. We want you to hearken diligently unto Yahweh. We want you to investigate everything and prove all things, hold fast that which is good. And if everything and anything was got out of what was said today from all of the speakers, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That will conclude today's class. We're sorry for the technical difficulties and the glitches, and we'll try to figure it out and work it out. Do we have any announcements? Okay. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, from Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because it's truthfully the place where you can learn something true about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Enjoy your evening, everyone.